Oh. here in the past month or so, I was telling her how important the book of Ephesians was to my own faith journey, and I even shared that with the pulpit. And I thought really a couple weeks ago, after I got into the Old Testament last week and talking about Solomon's prayer for high wisdom, that I would be done with the book of Ephesians. But I found myself back in the book again this week. And this is again one of my all-time, one of my favorite passages from this particular letter in particular. And it's at the end of the letter, it's last chapter, chapter 6, and I'm sharing with you verses 10 through 20, and as you can see, I'm entitling this message, The Uniform for All of Life's Games. Let us share together the teachings of Holy Scripture. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of His power. Put on the whole armor of God so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle, brothers and sisters, is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but rather against the rulers, against the authorities, against the common cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day. And having done everything, stand firm. Stand therefore and fasten the belt of truth around your waist. And put on the breastplate of righteousness as shoes for your feet. Put on whatever makes you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all of these, take the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. And take on also the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always persevere in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare boldly as I must speak. May God add God's blessing to the reading of God's word. The first organized sport I was ever able to participate in my life was the sport of baseball. And back in those days, you started in what was called Junior League. It's what they call today T League, where they actually pitched to you, and you had to hit that moving ball that came across the plate. And of course, playing in organized baseball, you got a uniform. Matching shirts and pants and socks and hat. A little patch, you know, a little number on the back. Now, there was one additional piece of equipment for me because they thought I was good at catching the ball, so they put me in the position of catcher. And from those of you who have ever played baseball, it was a requirement that if you were going to be a catcher, part of your uniform was what was called a cup. I never found those cups very comfortable. But it was part of the uniform required to wear. In junior high, at Anderson Highland Junior and Senior High School, I was able to be a member of the football team. Oh my goodness. The uniform football players wear is incredible. You put on these pants that have pads on the thighs and pads on the knees. You also got a hip pad that you put on before you put your pants on. You also have shoulder pads, a helmet, and a thing for your teeth. And if you were a quarterback, which I was, they also had this padding that went around your waist to protect you, that when you were like this, somebody hit you in the ribs, it wouldn't break it. I can tell you that even practicing football was no fun with all that stuff, let alone the games. Basketball uniforms, by the way, I loved them. They were very comfortable, quite airy, flexible, let you do whatever. Then I got to be an adult, and I got jobs in particular locations, and certain jobs would require a uniform. Even in this job, I have a self-imposed uniform. It's not the same colors, but I feel like beginning before you, I should be professional and I should at least wear a tie. And you'll notice every Sunday, I always have a tie on. I feel like it's part of my work uniform. We all have uniforms for life. I know for my wife, when she's going to go out and do hard work in the yard, she puts on her dirty clothes. When she's going to go to formal things, she puts on her nice clothes. When you go to the beach, you wear one kind of uniform. And when you go to the ball, you wear another. But what this passage in the Apostle Paul is trying to get at is there's another uniform we can put on every day. A uniform that will take care of all the things that can happen in your journey of life. To protect you, to guide you, and to give you what you need to deal with life's game. And he calls it the armor of God. But before we get into the armor, he sets up the reason why we need to put this armor on. He tells us to be strong in the Lord and to find strength in his power. He tells us that we need this armor so that we can withstand the wiles of evil. And most importantly, brothers, he tells us that our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, authorities, cosmic powers, and heavenly and spiritual forces of evil. I've noticed so often in my journey of life that many of us humans think that those who are different from us are our enemies. And Paul's saying, no, that's not what's going on here. Our battle is not with whether we're Republican or Democrat, or whether we're American or English or African or German. Far too often in our humanity's journeys, we have interpreted the things of life as our battles against each other. And Paul is reminding us, that's not where the battle is. The battle is around and above. It's the authorities and the principalities and the spiritual evil that is at work and has always been at work in our world. We've got a lot of battles going on in today's culture and world right now. But it's not against each other. It's against what's wrong and what's a lie and what is evil and what is good and what is true and what is righteous.
Amen.
I gave you this example a few weeks ago when me and Sherry were doing the youth ministry and we were having our new carpet put in the aisleway. And we told all the kids, we're not using the narthex today, we're going to get to the other end of the building through the back hallway. All the kids heard it, but two kids decided to do exactly the opposite of what we told them. We giggle about that, but that's what we humans do. Exactly the opposite of what God tells us to do. Exactly the opposite of what we know is righteous and good and true. Look at all the lifestyles that are out in today's 21st century world. Some of them because of the advancements in medical technology. And they're a lie. And we want to accept it and honor, be appreciative, and all get along. But our battle is not with the individual. It's against those lies, those spiritual forces of evil, those cosmic powers of today's present darkness, and the authorities and the rulers that only rule for themselves and not for us. Therefore, in order to survive, Paul says, take on the whole armor, so that on that day, you can stand and stand firm. The first item of clothing that he addresses is the item that holds the whole outfit together. It goes all around us, front, back, side to side. The belt of truth. You know, if you live a truthful life, you don't have to remember all the lies you told.
Amen.
If you live a truthful life, then you're living with God because God is truth, just like God is love. Or you could say that opposite. Truth is God. Love is God. We have a world today that likes to live in its fantasies, likes to live in its Hollywood television movie productions, likes to think that everything is just a figment of our imagination. It is not living in the truth. When I was a young kid, I would tell Mom one thing that was a lie, and then Dad would come and confront me, and I'd have to remember the lie I told to Mom to tell Dad the same lie, and it would catch up with me. And then I was in twice the trouble. But when I learned to tell the truth, I didn't have nothing to hide or cover for anymore. And when confronted with my behavior and my actions, I could stand in that truth, whether it was good or right or wrong or bad, and say, well, that's what I did, and that's the truth. It's important, especially for the future generations, that we show them the difference between what is true and what is a lie. Because I'm sorry, brothers and sisters, Google, Facebook, and AI is not going to show them the truth. I had a discussion with my wife this past week about our new topic for the kids, the Trinity. And I told my wife, I said, just be understanding that you're delving into a very deep subject. And she went to Google. And I went, Sherry, how are you going to find the truth on Google? Why don't you go to here? See what so many of us do, and we think we're living the truth, and we're being misled by the powers and principalities in this world to accept lies. Paul says, don't. When you get dressed in the morning, with your nice looking clothes to go out and present yourself to the world, make sure you put on the belt of living the truth. And don't let the lies deceive you and take you down a journey that you can't recover from. And the second item is very much like the first one, the breastplate of righteousness. One of the things that gives me confidence in the work that I do is that I know what I do in God's work is righteous. And as long as I'm not playing some game that I'm hiding from all of you and living a righteous life, I can walk into that situation and be confident. Because I know I'm righteous. Not because of what I've done, but because of what God has done for me and how He works through me for His righteousness. It's just like living the lie and living the truth. When you know you are righteous and you're living God's righteousness, you don't have to worry about what comes your way. But when you're living a lie, then when confronted, the whole breastplate seems to cave in and fall off. But that also means a breastplate of righteousness is that when you walk into a situation, you're going to do what is good and righteous for all those involved, not what's just good for you. That's what Jesus did when He died on the cross. He took it on with the breastplate of righteousness. And He didn't do it for Himself. He did it for all of us. And so He could do that with dignity and with honor. And know that God had Him. And as shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. This is especially true in politics, but I've seen it in today's church too. People walk into a situation with shoes on, ready for war. They come prepared for battle. I'm going to show that person. I'm going to give them a what for. I'm going to teach them how they're all wrong. Jesus could have taken that same attitude with us, could He not? But instead, when Jesus confronted the powers and the authorities and the principalities, He did it with the gospel of peace. He even taught us, blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are the humble. Why is it more important for us humans to be right than to be peaceful? Cannot we be both? I think we can, but that's not the way the world teaches us. One of the things that I've learned in my almost 30 years of ministry is that if I'm going to be successful and do God's work, I better put on the shoes of the gospel of peace instead of confronting everyone with words of agitation, of confrontation. Of where they are all wrong and I'm right. And how they need to straighten themselves up and fly straight. To come into a situation as a peacemaker instead of a warmonger. To come in seeking to find what is common and what we can work together and how we can negotiate maybe a common deal that works for all of us. You can't do that with shoes that are prepared for war. You can only do that with shoes that are ready for the proclaim the gospel of peace. And with all these, take on the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. In all the times in my life, whether it was back when I was playing baseball or playing football, I always believed in my heart that God had me. And when the car broke down on the wrong side of town and I was all alone before there were cell phones and thought my life was in danger, I could still take with me that shield of faith that God is going to protect me, that God's got me. It's following in the footsteps of Jesus. When God told him to go to Jerusalem and take on the cross. You remember in the garden? Got a picture right over here. You know, if there's any other way, Lord. Oh, there's no other way. I've got to take on the cross and plead to death in front of everybody. All right, I'm going to trust you got me. I'm going to trust that you've got this taken care of, God. Can we do that? That's what that shield is for. To not only quench the flaming arrows, but to give you confidence that no matter what's going on in your life, God's got you covered. And in the same vein, the helmet of salvation. I've made some mistakes in my life. There's been times when I was not good to God's children and I was completely ignoring of God. And yet with the helmet of salvation is the knowledge that Jesus died for me and that He's forgiven my sins. And if Jesus died for me and God can forgive my sins, He can forgive your sins. And if He can forgive your sins, He can forgive those other folks that we want to judge and their sins. That's the helmet of salvation. That God loves us all and will save us all. I've always said that the most important thing for a Christian to do is to love God's commandments. And what is God's first commandment? To love God and to love God's children, our neighbors. If we are truly a follower of Jesus Christ, why do we condemn our neighbors? Why is it even part of our language to say that person's going to hell? That person's no good. We should hope for our neighbor's salvation as Christians, shouldn't we? Or should we hope for their condemnation? See the contradiction we Christians have existed in? Yeah, I'm saved, but you poor little sot. Nope. That's not ours. We are to love them. We are to hope for their salvation, just as we hope for our own. And all of my choices and decisions that I make now in life are based on the premise that I am saved. And it's not because I saved myself, but it's because God, through Christ on the cross, saved me. And in my smallness, I can now share that good news with young and old alike, that God has saved them too. And of all these pieces, these pieces of armor, these garments, if you will, or whatever you want to term them, if you notice, all of them are pretty much defensive except the last one. When Paul addresses the sword. But the sword is not the way we think of as a sword, like a knife or a blade. The sword is the Word of God. When Jesus was in the wilderness after He was baptized, for 40 days, evil came to Him and tempted Him. First of all, tempted Him with food. He was hungry. How did He respond? He quoted Scripture. Man shall not live by bread alone. And He tempted Him with power. And what did Jesus do? He quoted Scripture. And He tempted Him with the other temptation, and again, Jesus quoted Scripture. It is helpful in this world to have knowledge, to know how the world operates. But real wisdom comes from knowing the Word of God and our fight with evil in our world does not require that we kill them as a soldier would with his sword, but to slay them with the Word of God, the sword of the Spirit. Works so much better and is a much better weapon than anything humanity has ever created. He ties it all together with prayer. We talked last week about prayer and about prayer for higher wisdom and a prayer to stay alert, to always persevere. And Paul ends his passage of praying for him also because he is imprisoned. An ambassador in chains, he calls them. Many think that it was this prison guard that gave him the idea, the inspiration, to talk about the armor of God. And there could be some truth to that. But I want you to think about what Paul was saying to us while he's behind bars. Of course, for a lot of us today, we would already judge Paul because we would call him a felon. But you know, a lot of us in this world were felons also. We just never got caught. But here he is in jail, in prison, not feeling sorry for himself, not talking about all this mean, old, nasty world that he lived in, talking about being a proclaimer of God's Word and telling us how to put on the armor we need to deal with the life around us. Has God ever asked any of you to be imprisoned because you believe in Him? Has God asked any of you to shed a drop of blood to believe in Him? I would say no. Nor has He asked me. And yet, one of the greatest missionaries in the history of the Christian faith is sitting in prison praising God and teaching us how to get suited up to face the day and to face life and give us the whole armor that we need to be able to withstand and to overcome. Brothers and sisters, I share this message for you today because of all of life's games I see going on in today's culture. And I see the many uniforms we Christians try to put on to fight these games. Our Christian t-shirts. Or our Christian knowledge. And yet, I have to agree that with Paul in this letter, it is time for us to put on the whole armor. Each and every day. The uniform for life's games. Sometimes it may not be as comfortable as we like. Sometimes it might not suit the occasion in our feelings and expressions. And yet I will guarantee you that if you can put on the full armor, you can not only live a godly led life, but you can withstand the attacks that life will bring to you from the evil forces and the principalities and powers that are at our work in today's world. I suppose if there's one thing to add to Paul's passage, is that we've got to follow our leader. We know our leader. We know what he did. We know what he taught. We know him in our hearts and our spirits. And we need to look to him for guidance and direction, not to Google, not to AI, not to the ways of the world.